Hello, can you hear me? Good afternoon. Welcome. Welcome to our 21st annual biomedical lecture series. And now, for all first-timers, I want to especially welcome you. And we are delighted to have you here. Now it's my distinct pleasure and honor to introduce our new Vice President of Academic Affairs and Dean of the Faculty, Dr. Wolfgang Natter, to give a few welcome remarks. Wolfgang.
Thank you, Lakshmi. Well, good afternoon. It is a great pleasure to welcome Dr. Jack Goldberg, Dr. Lakshmi Acheson, my dear colleagues, students, and other members of the Chestnut Hill community to today's lecture. As you know, the college has sponsored an annual distinguished biomedical lecture for a number of years now, and today's lecture by Dr. Jack Goldberg will be the 21st of the series. Ably overseen all these years by Dr. Acheson, the series is one of the most lustrous events in the college's academic calendar. For 21 years now, scientists of vision and achievement have spoken to our community, met with students and faculty, and brought their passion for learning and discovery to Chestnut Hill College. Our guest speakers have included elected members of the National Academy of Sciences, Nobel laureates, endowed professors, department chairs, and research institute directors at some of this nation's most renowned research universities and facilities. I am very grateful to Dr. Goldberg for accepting our invitation to continue the tradition. In a moment, I shall be turning the mic over to Dr. Acheson, who will introduce Dr. Goldberg's history of distinguished achievements for you. Before I do, however, I want to introduce our lecture series organizer. Dr. Acheson has been a faculty member at Chestnut Hill College since 1992, and full professor of biology since 2002, a department she has also served as chair. Professor Acheson has taught widely in the areas of cell and molecular biology, as well as on science and technology, bioethics in medicine, plant morphology, and biology and ecology. She is a recipient of the Lindbach Award for Distinguished Teaching and has received recognition from the Human Anatomy and Physiological Society, as well as the American Association for Cancer Research. She has been awarded a patent by the United States Patent and Trademark Office for the blood cell model she developed. And recently, she was able to celebrate the third edition of her book on cancer biology basics and prevention strategies that can affect high school and college age students. Dear students, if you have not seen the book, please make a point to take a look at it. Dr. Acheson exemplifies for me the maxim that good teaching is informed by good research, and equally that good research is informed by good teaching. Her own credo, the four P's, regarding what constitutes successful teaching, can make every good teacher even better, and are well incarnated by Professor Lakshmi Acheson. Passion, patience, politeness, and power. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Acheson to the podium.
Thank you, Wolfgang. That's very kind of you. That's a wonderful, more than I wanted to hear. A quick announcement for spring 2015. Our speaker will be Dr. Gerald Eisenberg from Jefferson Medical Hospital, and he will be talking about colon cancer. I asked him to give a catchy title, so he said, "Think outside of the box, look into the colon." Okay. So spring, March 18th is the date. Stay tuned for more details. Studying blood cell model, blood cell is always a passion of mine. A pin drop of blood can reveal so much about a person. The cell types, the blood pathology, the leukemia, the genetics, and many other details what a person can carry. Leukemia and lymphoma, unfortunately, affect people of all ages. About 127,000 people get it annually. And also among leukemia itself, 48,000 people get each year annually. This is 2013 report. Unfortunately, 23,000 people die, all ages, in leukemia. And there are also many other types of leukemia and blood cell disorders. Just to mention a few, there is so much to be known, little information is known about these. Since 2005, I wanted to invite a specialist in hematology and leukemia, and today my dream has come true. And therefore, it gives me genuine pleasure, immense pleasure, to introduce to you our special guest speaker, Dr. Jack Goldberg. I am so grateful to you that you accepted my invitation in spite of your busy schedule and to spend this entire afternoon with us on behalf of our president, Dr. Sister Carol Jean Vail, Dr. Wolfgang Natter, and Sister Dr. Cecilia Kavanaugh, SSJ, and the college community. I am grateful for your presence. Dr. Goldberg received his bachelor's degree from Boston University and medical degree from SUNY Upstate Medical Center. He did his residency in hematology and oncology at the University Hospital Boston and fellowship at SUNY. And Dr. Goldberg started his faculty appointments as associate professor, assistant professor of medicine and associate professor of pathology at SUNY Syracuse. He then joined as full professor at Robert Wood Johnson Medical Center in New Jersey. In 2003, he was appointed as clinical professor of medicine at the University of Pennsylvania. In addition, Dr. Goldberg also has held many administrative and hospital appointments. Just to mention a few, too, he was the head of medical oncology at Cooper Health System, and he was also co-director of Blood Bank, Cooper Health, and director of Adult Hemophilia Center at Cooper Health, and many more. Currently, he is Chief of Hematology and Medical Oncology, Chief of Abramson Cancer Center at Penn Presbyterian. Dr. Goldberg is board certified in American College of Internal Medicine, Hematology, and Oncology, and a licensure of New Jersey and Pennsylvania. Dr. Goldberg is recognized in Philadelphia Magazine. You can see yourself in 2005, 6, 7, 8, 9 as top doc issues, recognized by America's top doctors in 2007 and 8, and recognized in New Jersey and South Jersey magazines. He has a long list of honors and awards. There is a huge list. Just to mention two, he received Silver Chalice Award from American Cancer Society, and he also received the Service to Mankind Award from Leukemia and Lymphoma Society, and there is a huge list. He is affiliated member in many professional and national societies like American College of Physicians, Fellow of American Society of Hematology, American Society of Clinical Oncology, member of International Society of Geriatric Oncology, Leukemia and Lymphoma Society, and many more. Dr. Goldberg has an impressive list of clinical expertise. This is mind-boggling. In one lifetime, he's still continuing to do that. It includes breast cancer, hematology, Hodgkin's lymphoma, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, prostate cancer, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, multiple myeloma, and other myeloproliferative diseases. In addition, most importantly, he has developed geriatric oncology, research program, palliative care, including hospice, leukemia and lymphoma, and bone marrow transplant, hematopoietic stem cell research. He has published numerous papers in peer-reviewed research articles in cutting-edge research journals. And most importantly, he is, Dr. Goldberg is also doing cutting-edge clinical research of the 21st century. In my communication with Dr. Goldberg, he mentioned that he uses cord blood. I was fascinated. More than, as many, some of you may know, more than 45 diseases are treated with cord blood. And I call it an undisputed miracle juice of the century, the lifesaver. They are still celebrating the 25th anniversary of the cord blood, since it was introduced in 1988, if I'm correct. Today, Dr. Goldberg will talk about the research in hematopoietic stem cell biology, stem cell transplantation using peripheral cord blood and cord blood, and cell culture models, and how they are connected in treating leukemia. He told me in his email, I don't want to give away the final ending, but I will leave you in some suspense. There you have it. So hang on to your seats, ladies and gentlemen. It is my distinct honor and privilege to introduce to you the 21st Annual Biomedical Lectures Distinguished Speaker. Would you all join me to give a very warm welcome to Dr. Jack Goldberg.
Wow. You're right, I'm going to have that on print. Thank you very much for the invitation to be here. Thank you very much for the honor and privilege of being here. And I'm delighted, I'm glad to see all the students here as well. This is a very open lecture, so please interrupt, ask questions, no problems at all. So it really is a delight. You have a wonderful lecture series, and some of the most prominent people in the field of medicine and science have been at this podium and given discussions here. So I'm really very privileged and proud to be one of them. Just the bow tie, just so you know about the bow tie. I'm not a weatherman, but I do have a bow tie. When I started in medical school, I wanted to be a pediatrician, and my mom worked at a factory where she put the labels on the back of long ties. You know how you have a little label at the back? So when she saw a tie that she really liked and she wanted to buy, she put the label on crooked, and they would take the defective ties and they let the employees buy that, the workers buy it. So she bought me some of the most gorgeous ties. So I really loved my long ties. I put my long ties on, and then I started going through my pediatric rotation. And so I was going to be a pediatrician. I had the children in my arms, and what did they do? They peed on my ties. And so that's when I said, you know what, pediatrics I don't think is for me, and furthermore, I got to get something rather than a long tie. And so that's when I looked at my pediatric colleagues, and looked, they all had bow ties. And they go like, yeah, that's why. That's why I have a bow tie. So my pediatric colleagues made me get into it, and then my chief of medicine, William J. Williams, was the one who started me on bow ties. So that's the story of the bow ties. E pluribus unum, from many one. So I got into this business as I became a fellow in hematology and medical oncology. I wanted to do some research, and there was a medical technologist. We have a medical technology school. And one of the things that a medical technologist had to do was to do a research project. So she was working, this is now in 1973, she was working in the lab on this little project of taking these culture dishes, like you would for bacteria, and she would sort of grow blood in there. And then she would put them in an incubator and they would grow. She invited me over to see what that was like, and I looked and I said, that's kind of weird. And I got kind of interested in that and followed her lead. She did all the work, and then I passed the baton to me, and that was when I started getting interested about the manufacturing of blood. I also, like Dr. Atchison mentioned, a love for morphology, for looking under the microscope and seeing cells. And so one of my fascinations was leukemia. So seeing these cells under the microscope and looking at these abnormal cells and how pretty they were and how bad they were, where do they come from, why are they there, and how do we get rid of them? And that was really what spurred me on to this career. This is a slide that I would give all the time in my old days. I don't give this slide anymore except to this lecture, and I'm glad to give it to this lecture. And this slide shows how we look at the bone marrow. So I'm giving you sort of the end of the story, and then I'll bring you to the beginning of the story. If when you look at your blood, and you get a blood test, you've all had blood tests, I'm sure. You've all been told what your white count is, what your hemoglobin is, are you anemic or not anemic, what your platelet count is. We all take that for granted. Dr. Atchison has made a beautiful 3D model because blood is really flowing. It's in our blood. It doesn't look like it is on the slide. The slide is squashed. And we stain and squash it, but really it's a three-dimensional cells. They're flowing through our body. And I'm going to try to give you an idea of where they came about, what we know about them, and what we do with them. You'll see here we've got red cells, platelets, and different types of white blood cells shown here. Well, the most prevalent white blood cell in our blood is what's called the neutrophil. Anybody know how long that lasts in our blood? 6 hours. At the end of the day, you're working on your third set of white cells. 6 hours, that's it. And you need those white cells to fight infection, because that's really what your blood does. Your blood is ready to defend. It defends against bleeding with platelets. It defends against infections with white blood cells. There's complement in the plasma. There's antibodies in the plasma. So you've got a liquid system and a cellular system. And today, we're going to talk about the cellular system. So the white cells, 6 hours. The platelets, 10 days. And they're unusual cells. The platelets, the analogy of them is like looking at a dandelion. As you see a dandelion, it grows as a sort of yellow flower, and then all of a sudden it buds, right? And all the buds fall off of it. That's how a megakaryocyte, that's how platelets are formed. There are big cells that are like dandelions, and the platelets just break off. There's no other body cell that does that kind of manufacturing of platelets, and they only last 10 days. And the red cells, they're what I call gummy bears with the hole filled in. They're biconcave discs. They're really not flat. They don't have a hole in them. They're filled. And they're very, very plastic. They're able to move. The reason that they have to move is because the body has to figure out who's old, who's new, and to keep new ones and refresh the body all the time. And what happens to these red cells is their main function in life is, and if you look, all these cells, they have no nuclei. They have no way of making more of each other. They're made. They're the final product. They came out of the factory, and that's it. So the red cells bring oxygen from the lung and deliver it to the tissue. The platelets are glue bags that, when something is busted, they open and up and fill the hole. It's like spackling the wall, putting a big piece of spackle in a hole, and then the body comes in and just cements that and then sands it off, and we got a brand new blood vessel. And the white cells are geared up to infection. They make it and fight an infection, or they don't. They got 6 hours to do it. If they last in the tissues, they've got 24 hours. And we have a spleen that begins to figure out who's in and who's out. A very cellular filter, like the kidney is a filter for the plasma, the spleen is the filter for the cells. So this is where I started life, looking under the microscope and saying, wow, what are those things and what happens when things don't go right? And these megakaryocytes and platelets, how does it happen? And a whole other area called lymphocytes and immune cells. What's responsible? Well, if you go in your garden and put in an acorn or a seed, you get a plant. You get the limbs of the plant, you get branches of the plant, finally the flowers, pick them off, and you get more flowers, more plants. It rejuvenates itself. So the marrow needs to rejuvenate itself. How does it do it? Who are the players? And that's where I got into the research. So these dishes were where we were going, but let me tell you how the dishes developed. And I'll go through these terms in a moment. So, way up top. So, this whole field began in about the 1960s, basically about 50 years ago. So, 50 years ago, there was work done to try to understand how the bone marrow works. And so, two very important people in my life were Dr. Tillin McCullough from Canada. This is an international, and I'll tell you about the bone marrow function, was all international. Most of it was done in Canada and Australia, and a little of it in the United States, believe it or not. So we're not so US-centric here when it comes to the bone marrow function and understanding. So what they did in 1964, very simple experiment. They took mice that were litter mates. They took one of the mice that was a litter mate, and they treated it with lethal radiation. That mouse would not survive had nothing else been done. And they took the other litter mate, took the marrow out of that litter mate, and pushed it in the veins of the lethally irradiated mouse. The first bone marrow transplant ever, period. And what they found is that the mouse that was lethally irradiated survived. But they found another very interesting thing. It was very important. And that was that when they did the autopsy on the mouse that survived, they found marrow growing in the spleen. And they could quantify it. They could measure these lumps on top of the spleen. And they finally figured it out that these lumps were coming out of some cell that was really making bone marrow in the mouse. And they called it colony-forming unit spleen. So, in this 1965, that material and that studies were done. Now, it was hard to do experiments. They did figure it out. They did show that these cells existed. They showed that they could replicate themselves as well. So these were primitive stem cells. And we identified this as primitive. Can you find them? Can you look at them? Can you see them in the microscope? And the answer is no. They look like ordinary lymphocytes. They're not morphologically distinguishable, but they are distinguishable by what they do, which is when you lethally irradiate something and you throw it into the veins, somebody recovers, and then you see the recovery in the spleen, and you can measure the recovery. So you can use less marrow, more marrow, you can change the marrow, do all kinds of things to try to identify this better. And the assay was called colony-forming units spleen. And that is the way we have now to measure that particular entity. Well, you know, I gotta tell you, I've done it. Trying to get blood out of the tails of these mice and trying to inject them into lethally irradiated is not for the faint of heart. And it's not something you're gonna do for a livelihood, let me tell you. So people try to figure out another way. What about a dish? So we know bugs grow in agar, right? We have standard agar. Well, let's do agar. So we developed these double-layered agar dishes, and we tried to grow cells. And so the first thing you need to do is you have to the magic formula, right? So you need some kind of nutrient agar. Because as you know, when you grow bacteria, you need a certain agar and certain nutrient for certain bugs, and you can selectively do that. Same thing for the cells. So we needed to find a good source. We needed to find a media where they would grow. And we had to find a way of doing that. And we needed something that would stimulate the growth, which was underneath the agar, called the feeder layer. So we had a feeder layer, we had an overlayer, and we had finally colony-forming units in culture versus colony-forming units in a spleen. And these turn out to be progenitor cells. And these are the cells, again, not visible. You can't look at them in the microscope. The only way you know they exist is because you put them in a dish and they grow. And you look at the dish and it's in 3D. And they form lumps called colonies, and they form smaller lumps called clusters. What do they mean? What are they? Was really what I got very interested in. And you put them in a dish, you take them from bone marrow, put them in a dish, that would make sense. If you're going to look at bone marrow function, where do you look? Look in the bone marrow. So you basically take bone marrow, and I'll get to that in a minute. That's not easy either. You got to go to your hip, you got to stick a needle in, you got to get that out, and who's going to volunteer? Right. So starting this experiments and looking at that was really not the easiest thing. And there were lots of different cells that are involved in this hierarchy as well. So we've got this CFUS, the spleen, pluripotential stem cell, which makes everybody, white cells, red cells, platelets, and lymphocytes. And then we have other cells in between, which we call progenitor cells, which we could evaluate with the CFU, colony-forming units, putting them in a dish. But they weren't really stem cells. They triggered either going to the white cell series or the red cell series or the megakaryocytes, and we gave them names. If we sort of drove that by adding stimulating factor, and these are peripheral blood cells that we put in there, and if it drove to granulocytes, to white cells, we called it CFUGM, granulocyte macrophage. If they're red cells, we called it erythroid. And if they're a megakaryocyte, we added the initial M. So we had this whole bunch of stuff, and we looked at each other, and everybody else looked at us and saying, that's science? My mentors were chemists. So my mentor, who really wanted me to go into that direction of research, was a protein chemist with coagulation. My other mentor was a lipid biologist looking at platelets, and my other mentor was a red cell enzyme person who did that. And they looked at me like I was kind of out of left field. I was out of left field. But I tried to figure out how it worked. So we had this, and we'll get back to this in a minute. So we have the CFUS in 1964, 65, and then we had the colony-forming units in about 5 years later, and we're trying to figure out how we can relate that to disease. Where are these cells coming from? How is the marrow made? What is the marrow? Can we evaluate it? And because this marrow is our immune system, lymphocytes, it's our white cells that kill bugs, it's red cells that help us breathe, and it's platelets that prevent us from bleeding to death. And they are rapid turnover. So where the heck is this all going on? And more important than that, and even further than what I just mentioned, is that some of these cells eventually end up in the tissues, very important cells. So bone marrow monocytes eventually can get into the liver and act as defending cells, antigen-presenting cells, defense cells in tissues. So they become tissue-bound in the lungs, in the liver, in the brain. And they have, all of these have a bone marrow origin, a stem cell origin. Wow. And the lymphocytes, they go through all kinds of hell. They end up in the thymus somehow, being programmed, and you can't tell one lymphocyte from the other. Let's take a trip down the bone marrow as we know it as it develops. So we, setting up the stage, we know the elements, we know what the marrow makes, we know the end product, because we look at the blood, we measure the blood, and we see red cells, white cells, and platelets. I'm a little ahead of the story, but I could do a bone marrow aspirate biopsy and put it on the microscope and look at it, but that's like taking one frame out of a movie and not knowing if it's the beginning, if it's the middle, if it's the end, or what the movie's all about. So it's like seeing a preview. So with that in mind, bone marrows are important. That's the only test we have. We don't have an x-ray for the bone marrow. We don't have any physiological way of knowing how it's working. We have a picture that we see at one point in time by taking out the bone marrow. So looking at bone marrow development is critical, because a lot of diseases are diseases of the bone marrow, which you talked about, leukemia and lymphoma. But let's take a look at what the journey of these stem cells are. And this, I think, to me, is absolutely fascinating. When we're born, bone marrow production, blood production, the fetus's manufacturing of cells, red cells. Now remember, fetus has to make a certain red cell, right? Because it's got to compete with mom for oxygen. So it has to make a certain red cell defined by fetal hemoglobin to capture blood, oxygen, nutrients from mom so it can grow. Bingo. Okay. Where are they made? In the yolk sac. So the primitive yolk sac of the developing fetus is where all the hematopoietic cells begin life. That's where they are. And then, because you can see here, these are months, and then this is postnatal and prenatal. So we're going to move along here on the curve a little bit. So everything's in the yolk sac. And then you see, as time goes on, gestation, first trimester, pregnancy, first trimester, all of a sudden the yolk sac's gone, and guess who's picking up these stem cells? The liver. What the hell are we doing in the liver? And in the spleen, what the hell are we doing in the spleen? That's where the manufacture's going on. That's where the stem cells are. That's where the progenitor cells are. That's where bone marrow is being made at that point in time, in the middle of gestation. And then suddenly you see at the fourth month, we see something happen. The bone marrow. What the hell is that? Well, it turns out that the bones of our body have solid outsides and hollow insides. And in the middle of that hollow area is like a sponge network. Like you'd have a sponge, a real sponge, the live sponges, with holes in it, little holes, multiple holes. So that hole is there waiting to be populated by these stem cells that are coming out of the yolk sac that spend some time in the liver, spend some time in the spleen. And then eventually you're born. And now all of your marrow, the liver's gone, the spleen is gone from making marrow. But they all have a role to play in the processing of cells and helping with bone marrow function. Is that, you with me? They're remnants. It's like our appendix. What the hell is it there for? I don't know. We carry it along. It's still with us. So we can't get rid of it. So we still have remnants. And then the bone marrow. But one thing we found along the way, while I was looking at CFUCs, these colony-forming units, one of my colleagues was my classmate. He was a neonatologist. And he was looking at the dish and said, "This is kind of interesting stuff. What are you doing?" I said, "I'm growing white cells." He said, "No," I said, "nobody believes me. You're just growing your cells in dishes." And he said, "Have you ever thought of putting umbilical cord blood in there?" And we had a GYN group that had actually an artificial placenta, and they were trying to develop a system where they could look at placental function and placental physiology. Very unique. And so there was a lot of placenta interest at my institution in Syracuse. And my colleague, who's a neonatologist, says, "We deliver babies all the time, and they have umbilical cord blood, and we can give you some blood, and that's cells. You want to put them in a dish?" I said, "Sure, what the hell?" They grew. They grew just like bone marrow grew. So when you're born and everything happens to you and you're now out, the yolk sac's gone, the liver no longer makes bone marrow, the spleen no longer makes bone marrow, although they know how to do it. They know how to do it. And they also know how to get rid of cells too. So they still have a little bit of memory left, and we don't understand exactly what happens, but I'll get to that in a moment. But what happens is, for a short time, those circulating cells that were in the yolk sac, circulating in the fetus, are still circulating because everybody's filled up in the bone marrow. And so if you deliver a baby and you take umbilical cord blood, you've got about 50 to 100 cc's of rich bone marrow that you can put away and freeze for a rainy day. Guess what? Your blood has bone marrow in it, stem cells too. It doesn't have bone marrow, but there's a two-way street in the bone marrow. Cells going out and cells getting back in. And that's what led to bone marrow transplant. When you hear a bone marrow transplant, and I told you about the mice, the original experiment, same thing happens in humans. People think, "Oh, well, you take a bone marrow transplant. You take bone marrow out and then you put it back in the bones." And the answer is no. You take the bone marrow out, you put it in the blood, and the bone marrow cells find their way back to the bone marrow and they replenish the bone marrow and restore the bone marrow because that's how the yolk sac did it. Same route, in and out. And the stem cells can escape and go in the peripheral blood. And guess what? We can measure them. And we can tickle them to come out. Stem cells from the blood substituted instead for the bone marrow. And we do autologous stem cell transplants. When you hear the word autologous, it means it's your own stem cells. And we don't need your marrow. We can get it out of the blood by tickling them to come out of the blood. Y'all with me so far? One more thing I got to tell you is this fancy spleen. So we don't know hell beans about the spleen, except what happens when you don't have a spleen. Anybody know what happens when you don't have a spleen? Nothing. You're fine. Your blood counts are fine. They're a little bit higher than they used to be, but you're fine. So who the hell is doing, what did the spleen do in the first place? Well, that's a very good filter. Let me give you an idea how good a filter it is. The spleen sits there, gets about 20% of your blood supply at any point in time. Your red cells are 7 microns in diameter. The spleen is had sinusoids and cells lining it called macrophages, and the red cells flowing, as a 3D model shows, flowing through the blood, gets into the spleen to try to get out the other side, vein, artery. And as it goes through the spleen, it goes from a 7 micron size to a 3 micron hole in the spleen. How do you do that? You got to shimmy through, right? You got to be like a basset hound. You got to go skin first, out the other end. So you're half your body to get to the other side. Because if that you don't make it, what happens? You're dead. And that's how we clean out our blood. So the 3 micron you got to get from 7 to 3. And how does the body know that? There's only enough energy for the red cell to live 120 days. And as it lives longer, it gets stiff, like me. And you get stuck in the spleen. And guess what? Your parts are reused to make more and younger red cells. So that's what the splenic function is. And the only thing you need is if you don't have a spleen, the spleen does provide some immune protection against some bugs, pneumococcus, H flu, and meningococcus. So it has an immune function, but its main function is this. But remarkably to me, this very elaborate function, very elaborate process, you take it out, throw it in the garbage can, and who the hell needed it in the first place? The liver does it. We don't know how. We haven't got a clue. So umbilical cord blood, peripheral yolk sac, obviously. Umbilical cord blood, still a remnant, and useful and active stem cells, and we can measure them with the CFUC. And then you get old. You have bone marrow everywhere when you're born. In the vertebrae, in the pelvis. Remember, these are all bones. Hard on the outside, soft on the inside, sponge. Everything attaches. And so it attaches in the vertebrae, in the pelvis, in the sternum, ribs, femur. But look what happens. As you get older, you lose it. And it's not use it or lose it, you lose it. And so the tibial function is gone, the femur is all gone. But it's interesting. If you get very anemic and you need to make marrow, they'll open up for you. If you really get diseased and you need marrow, the liver and spleen will open up for you. So all of these transit places that began from the embryo in disease states goes the other way. And ta-da, there's a picture. All the red spots are where, when you're born, that's where your marrow is. And when you get older, all of this stuff goes away. There's a little left in the sternum and a little left here. And this is where we get your bone marrow from. That's why we do it there in the hip. And we take out some marrow and we look at it, but we're only looking at one picture. So, bone marrow, the blood is there, it's spongy interior, there are holes there, but it is really an extremely organized system. Why? Because the white cells only last 6 hours, the platelets last a week, and the red cells last 120 days. That's a lot of work. That's quite a liquid machine that has to maintain that and not break down. When it breaks down, we got trouble. We got trouble in a hurry because we need all those to breathe, the oxygen, the red cells, the delivery, the exhaustion, the platelets, because you don't have them, you're going to bleed, and the white cells, you need them to protect against infection. So this is what it looks like when we do it under the microscope. And it's certainly not like Dr. Atchison's model by any means. This is really a liquid structure, but what we do is we take a needle in the back of your hip that you saw from that area here, because that's where, and the reason we do it from the back of the hip, well, we can also do it from the sternum. Nobody wants to do, I don't do that no more. It's sitting there, sticking a needle in there, where your heart's about here, and your bone marrow is here, and there's about that much space, and that's kind of tricky. But anyways, here, you got a lot more rubber to go through. So you go through there and the spine is very near the skin, so you can do that, so you can collect the tissue. if you're doing a bone marrow transplant, believe it or not, you go in the OR, this is what we do, did, still do, and you put needles in that area and you just suck it up until you get a liter bottle of Coca-Cola, or blood, in this case, bone marrow. And you take that liter bottle of bone marrow and you see if it's got an adequate number of CFUC, that you've gotten enough of it, those stem cells, progenitor cells, and you freeze it away, swoosh it down, and that's your bone marrow transplant organ that you then give by blood to restore somebody, your own bone marrow or somebody else's bone marrow. That's autologous or allogeneic. But we found out that bone marrow actually exists in the blood. It's a lot cleaner, you can stimulate it, you don't have to do that, and we actually do stem cells from the peripheral blood, and they work just as well, and that was discovered through the CFUC process as well. And while I'm doing that, actually, let me tell you how, what happened. It was all accidental. I didn't want to do bone marrows anymore because it was a pain in the neck, and then I asked my thoracic surgeons, because they were opening up the sternums. I said, can you give me some of the juice? It was all clotted. It was a mess. So by self-preservation and maintaining my research, I said, let's just look at blood. And so we started looking at blood at all kinds of diseases and peripheral blood, and we defined that it was there. I had a, this is for all of you young scientists. The fellow joined me, he was a pediatric hematologist. His name was Ronnie Newberg. And so he said, you know, I treat a lot of kids with ALL, and I'd like to know about their bone marrow function in ALL and acute lymphatic leukemia and how they recover. So I said, sure, join the lab. So he started working in the laboratory with me, and he was looking at peripheral blood, so we doing cultures, and he said to me, you know, it's something bizarre. I said, what's that? He said, and he showed me the data, that when you treat a patient with acute lymphatic leukemia, you give them lots of chemotherapy, and you don't see any stem cells in peripheral blood. But all of a sudden, before you see the bone marrow return, and before you see anything, there's this ton of bone marrow in the blood. And he showed me the dishes, and he showed me the data, and he said, I ain't lying. This is real. And so we thought this was a stimulus to recovery. And he started writing abstracts. We sent a proposal to the NIH, and they said, you're nuts. You're crazy. It doesn't make any sense. Go away. This is pure artifact. And he was disappointed. He went into practice. About 3 years later, someone discovered the same thing. They discovered stem cell harvesting. That's what we discovered by accident. Given chemotherapy, these bone marrow stem cells that were rising up to make bone marrow, recovering from the chemo, were squirting out in the blood. And you could harvest them, there was as many of them or more that there would be in a normal bone marrow. And you could collect them by machine, pheresis, you can put them in a bag, and you didn't have to do bone marrow, and it worked as well, and it worked fast. But there's a key to this. One thing I didn't tell you is, while we learned all this, we learned about a very important thing. What makes it grow? And that was called stimulating factor. We called it colony. If there were colony forming units that had something to stimulate it, that was called colony stimulating factor. What the hell was that? Well, let me tell you, a lot of people spent a lot of time trying to develop and produce erythropoietin and granulopoietin, these stimulating factors. And it wasn't until recombinant technology arose that, bingo, it was made. And colony stimulating factor came about, and it made bone marrow transplantation what it is today. So that was a success story. But we began to learn also from the CFUCs and these progenitor cells how leukemia comes about. But again, the story of bone marrow production and function is still really unclear. Here's another way of looking at it. These are the progenitors, the stem cells. Remember, the definition of the stem cell was a CFUS. That was in a mouse model, and the characteristic of that is it was capable of self-renewal, that a stem cell could make more of itself. The progenitor cells, the CFUs, you see there, GEM and BFUE, burst-forming units, megakaryocytic, colony-forming units, erythroid, and we never really had anything for the lymphocytes. Lymphocytes, we didn't have any culture systems for them, but we had culture systems for these. So, about the 70s, another revolution took place. And that revolution was that people in their backyard, in their garage, in a basement, started making antibodies against cells. They figured they would take cells, put in a rabbit, make an antibody. And so they had these. There were local labs that were doing them. There were commercial labs that were doing them. Every antibody was given a name. Lu-M1, you name it, they had a name. And so it became this sea of antibodies that people had made against certain cells. Well, it turned out that you could use these antibodies to identify cells by putting them in a machine called a flow cytometry and looking to see if these cells were, what they were. Were they a B cell, a T cell? We tried to do them in a culture system where we grew them, and they grew one way and they made red cells, they were CFUE. If they grew, they made granulocytes, they were GM. We stimulated that regard, but is there another way? Is there an easier way? Is there a more quantitative way? And people started to look at that by making antibodies. And so these antibodies were important. And finally, in 1970, a whole symposium got together. Everybody brought their antibodies, and they had cell lines there. And they looked at the cell lines and said, OK, these antibodies recognize a certain group of cells. And they were called cluster designation. So when you see these words, they're all over the place, called CDs, they are cluster designation. Cluster designation because these were antibodies that were homegrown that seemed to react against this cell. The first 10, CD1 through CD10, are lymphocytes. Why? Because they were the easiest things for us to separate in the lab and the easiest for us to throw into a rabbit. All the way down, the next set, to CD20, 25, 30, they were immune cells, B cells. In fact, one of those antibodies turned out to be a very important treatment called Rituxan, because it directed against anti-CD20 for treatment of lymphoma. And one other one came about, anti-CD34, discovered at Hopkins. And they said, well, what's this? And it correlated with all the CFUCs. So it was a way of measuring these progenitor cells that up to that time we needed dishes for. So now when you hear the word CDs, and there are now hundreds of them, because they're being made and they're extremely important. It's how we identify cells, subsets of cells, all kinds of hematopoietic cells and immune cells using the CD, and tumor cells. They help us immensely in terms of diagnostics, and they're helping us now in therapeutics. So again, limited lifespan, manufacturing, but what I didn't tell you, and what I haven't got a clue to, is okay, they're CFUS, I buy that, they're stem cells, you showed me in the mouse. They're CFUCs, you put them in a dish, and you got a CD34, and you can use that as a surrogate, that's great. But how do they make the cells? And the answer is, haven't got a clue. We have no idea what happens after that. We know a black box, and then a box that we can look at in a picture of a microscope and see the cells, but we have no idea about the dynamics of that whatsoever. Kind of scary, isn't it? We do know one thing that we learned about these stem cells early on from the umbilical cord and peripheral blood is, guess what? They can make a whole bunch of stuff. And now you learn about the whole area of genetic engineering. So if you think about it, the DNA of this cell, or the DNA of all your cells, contains all of the DNA information that the sperm and the ovary had, right? That union, making that body, has all of the DNA in every cell from the union, right? But a cell becomes a lung cell because everything is turned off. What's turned on is what makes that cell a lung cell. It's a brain cell, is everything is turned off, but that's what exists as a brain cell. But guess what? You can turn the table around. And so it turns out that knowing about these stem cells, there is what we call plasticity. You might be able to encourage the stem cell to be a liver, to be a brain. And it turns out that some of the things that are bone marrow-derived function in the bone marrow also have something to do with the brain. For example, some of the brain cells that came out of the monocytes will react to erythropoietin. So it's a funky spectrum kind of situation that we're beginning to understand. We can re-differentiate. So progenitor cells, we talked about stem cells, and then, but how did they get to the mature cells, and what happens in between, we don't know. So there is a renewal capacity that they have to go through, a series of differentiation steps, but this proliferating end of it, you know, how do you go from one to the other? We see them morphologically, we look at them on the microscope, we're better off with a 3D dimensional way of looking at them, but we don't know how they get to the other end. And what makes them go? So the progenitor cells are important, we can measure them, CD34, but there's gotta be a way of the body knowing, let's make more, and it's gotta be right away. So in the white situation of the white cells, if you've got white cells in your blood, and you're getting infection, you want more. So you call up the troops, and the way the white cells are manufactured is, they're made, but then you begin to develop a Walmart. You basically store every single product you have. And so when the emergency comes in, they all go out. And then you worry about production. So if you have to wait for production, if we had to wait for production, for our white cells to fight, we'd be in big trouble. So there's already a built-up storage. But that pool, that storage, doesn't last long. But it can fight a fire until it can, and you see the problems when you lose that fight, like Ebola. So we understand that there's some way of messaging within the bone marrow and the blood that sends messages back. We know, we understand that system somewhat as far as erythropoietin. For example, in red cells are made in the bone marrow. The red cells go through the kidney. The kidney detects whether there's enough oxygen or not. If there isn't enough oxygen, it makes erythropoietin. That's a hormone, just like thyroid hormone, cortisol, but for the red cell, for the bone marrow, it's important because that signals make bone marrow, and more bone marrow is made faster in the direction of the red cells, so more red cells can be produced to go through that poor spleen. But here's what we understand in the bone marrow function. And this is very important because this is where everything gets stuck and broken. Because you have the manufacturing of these progenitor cells and stem cells that are limited, if they make a mistake, they make big mistakes. And it's the origin of the progenitor cell and really the stem cell where all the leukemia and all of the lymphomas, liquid tumors, myeloma resides. The defect is there, it got broke there. CML, chronic myelogenous leukemia, the Philadelphia chromosome, and you know that's a disease now we can fight with a pill rather than a bone marrow transplant. That's a disease of the stem cell. Acute lymphatic leukemia, that's a disease of the stem cell. Acute myelogenous leukemia, polycythemia vera, central thrombocythemia, myelofibrosis, a lot of different names because of the way they manifest clinically, but their origins are in this, in that stem cell. How does it get dysregulated? Here it is. Something happens. This is what we understand at the bone marrow level, but we don't understand what happens. But we do understand one thing. The machinery that this stem cell has to make every day is enormous, and it makes mistakes. And the mistakes are repaired, because we have ways of repairing the mistakes by apoptosis. We have suicide genes, but in the end, the mistakes happen. And if that mistake, genetically, in that cell, stimulated by these factors, is such that it has a better ability to grow than what you have now, you have leukemia. So if you've got a lousy lawn, and you've been growing Kentucky bluegrass, and all of a sudden the lawn gets bad, you're not gonna grow Kentucky bluegrass, you're gonna grow ryegrass or weeds, and that's leukemia. Something happens in this environment to set up the mutational event occurs, poor marrow function, and the bad guys appear. They weren't bad guys, they just stuck. And they're stuck in this level. But one other thing that we didn't talk about, and I'll talk about briefly here, is that, and this is really the open area, how does the body know to make marrow? What are the signals? We see now the local signals in the bone marrow that we showed here, but how about distant signals? We talked about erythropoietin, but we don't really know about it for platelets, and we don't really know about it for white cells. But we got names. So because of the dishes, because of the culture systems, we learned that we could make white cells appear in a dish because we put some stuff in there called colony stimulating factor. And it turns out this is now we use in humans, called neupogen, leukine. So we've now manufactured this recombinantly, but we don't really know how it works. We don't really understand how it works. We just know, thank God, it works. And it can stimulate stem cells, and it can make marrow, and it can hasten marrow. So we understand that. We know about erythropoietin. So it's a long way to go in this area. And so this is the final slides to really to show you that we now have names for all of these guys, and we now have stimulator factors for all these guys, and we're beginning to figure out what's broken. But it's an enormous task in trying to identify this. So what I'm trying to give you is not an answer, but a mission. We've gone from 1965 with that first stem cell. What have we developed out of all of that? Growth factors to help the bone marrow grow. Red cells to have red cell function. A better understanding about how marrow is made, where it's made, how it's made, what happens, and byproducts that we can use. Peripheral blood, bone marrow, umbilical cord blood, and those can be used to reproduce the bone marrow. And maybe even plasticity. People are working with umbilical cord blood and seeing if they can make brain tissue, make other tissue by sending in the umbilical cord and having it directed traffic to another organ site besides the bone marrow. And the stimulating factors to help us during times of anemia, during times where your platelets are low, or during times when you need something to help combat infection. What's enormous in here as well and very important, and we're learning much more about this as well, is that damn liver. The liver is loaded with proteins, and it's a major manufacturer of proteins. But the most important one, as far as the marrow is concerned, are immunoglobulins and complement. By far, the most important complement. So complement, we make tons of this. It is very elemental to all body, all organisms, but it is what kills bugs. And it is what is our basic detergent. And these all integrate together. What happens sometimes is that complement, which is our detergent, can overwhelm our normal cells, and the result is destruction of multiple organs that we see in patients who get very sick and have multi-organ function dysfunction. So bottom line is, it's one hell of a mechanism. It's one hell of an organism. I'm amazed we don't have more mistakes. We're able to repair those mistakes and not get leukemia, not get some of these. Why do we get these diseases? We don't know. We know that some of these are virally mediated, like, for example, ALL, Burkitt's leukemia lymphoma, by the EB virus. There is also a virus known as the T-cell virus, and so we understand that viruses may do that, but they're the minority. The majority are totally other diseases. So in summary, I've hopefully given you a tour through the area of hematopoiesis, of stem cells, but yet the black box is still black in terms of what's happening in between, where are the breaks, why do they occur, and how do we repair them? And we repair them out of the old-fashioned way. We give chemotherapy, wipe out the good guys, and let the good guys come back in and remake the bone marrow. So we take diseased lawns and put weed killer all over the place, and then wait for the good grass to come faster than the bad grass. Or replant them by using stem cells after we've given the detergent down. Questions?